Good evening and thank you everyone. I start by paying my respects to Dr. Hanuman. And I thank all of you for having me here, starting with Dr. Rajan, Dr. Jayesh for his wonderful introduction. And before I start, I must thank my secretary, Gokhale, who made this presentation, and Dr. Meghna and her team, who have helped me to put it up. So thank you to all of them, and thank you, of course, to all of you who have filled the hall. Bewildered by the fact that an engineer is going to talk to homeopaths about management on a Saturday afternoon. It is the weirdest thing I have done in my life. The reason I do it is very simple, because I love homeopathy and I love homeopaths. It's as simple as that. But I have been wondering for the last couple of months that Dr. Rajan invited me, why would he want me here today? And I found the answer when I was entering the gate. There is a big banner that says, for 3 days we are going to talk about survival, and we are going to talk about snakes and spiders and mollusks and reptiles and God knows what else. And I said to myself, you know, just like there is a circus where there are many dangerous animals and then you need a clown act to give some relief. So in the same way, after 2 days of talking about a ponderous subject like survival, you need a clown act at the end of the day. So I'm here to entertain you. Don't take me very seriously because I don't know much about homeopathy. But please keep clapping. You are free to whistle. And this is one session in which you can keep your phones on also. I don't mind. Friends, as far as I'm concerned, I started work at Bajaj 30 years ago, almost 30 years ago. In those days, Bajaj was best known as Hamara Bajaj. Hamara Bajaj was characterized by a scooter. The general perception of the scooter was of a low technology scooter, and the reality was that that scooter was never exported because the world didn't want to buy a low technology scooter. 30 years on, I am part of a Bajaj Auto, which, as it says on my sleeve, is known as the world's favorite Indian. It is characterized not by a scooter but by a motorcycle. Dr. Jayesh already referred to it. It is as high-tech as any motorcycle in the world. In fact, the brands we make now, Pulsar, Avenger, Dominar, KTM, Husqvarna, are technology leaders, not laggards. We set the benchmark now. And as fellow Indians, you will be proud to know that a company that could not export even one scooter at one time, and not so long back, 15 years back perhaps, in recent years, almost half of what we make are exported. We export to over 70 countries. And it's a matter of great pride for all of us in this room, because these are products that are designed, developed, made and marketed by Indians, by our brothers, sisters, sons and daughters, right? We don't need the government to tell us make in India. We know how to make in India. And we export to over 70 countries. You'll be proud to know, for example, 1 in 3 motorcycles in Africa is a Bajaj motorcycle. You will be proud to know that from Sri Lanka and Bangladesh to the Philippines and Cambodia to Colombia and Chile, Bajaj is the number one brand in these markets, and so on and so forth. And in my view and from my point of view, the greatest credit for this I give to homeopathy, because everything I learned about management, I learned from the Organon, I learned from various books on homeopathy, such as Dr. Kent's books, and of course, I have read as much as possible all of Dr. Rajan's books as well. So whatever I know, including all the mistakes I have made, is because of homeopathy. But that is about business. From a personal point of view, people sometimes ask me, what does homeopathy mean to you personally? And I tell them, to me, homeopathy, when I think about it, is like a giant tree. A tree so big that even if I glance from left to right, I cannot see the whole tree. A tree so alive, so green, so calm, with so much shade, under which I sit with my family and friends, and we feel good. Believe me, if I was speaking on management today, nobody from my family would have attended. But because I'm speaking on homeopathy, my eldest uncle, Mr. Shekhar Bajaj, chairman of Bajaj Electrical, is here in the front row. My number two uncle, Mr. Madhur Bajaj, vice chairman of Bajaj Auto, is also here in the front row. My sister is either here or she will be here. And there are other friends in the audience as well. So homeopathy and homeopaths have much more support and much more people who love them and respect them than you perhaps know yourself sometimes. But sometimes it dismays me that although we feel the tree of homeopathy is so great, some people, starting with sometimes homeopaths only, they are cutting the tree and using the wood to make a bridge. A bridge from homeopathy to politics. You know how? It is in four steps. In the first step, you go from homeopath to become a dentist. In the second step, on this bridge, you go and become an allopath. The third, you become a businessman, and finally, a businessman becomes a politician. So this bridge course is one of the things that has dismayed me most about homeopathy in recent years when I heard about this. Your science is so pure. Your science is so precious. I hope it will never be colored by such tactics from the outside. I used to tell my people this quote in the context of strategy. I will tell you in the context of homeopathy and such foolish things like this bridge course. There is a quote that says, "Ped kaatne kuch log aaye the mere gaav mein. Ped kaatne kuch log aaye the mere gaav mein. Dhoop tez hai ye kehkar baithe hain usi ki chhaav mein." This is homeopathy. Let us not cut this tree of homeopathy. Dr. Saab before me talked about some of the wrong notions about homeopathy. I want to share with you some of my experiences of the same. First of all, people cannot even spell homeopathy. They forget the O, which is there in the middle. But I think most people think, as Dr. Saab said, the spelling of homeopathy starts with S. The three S's what he described. I like to share with you my experience of these. First, I will share it with you basis my family, then I will talk about my business. Shahrukh, next one. So when I'm talking about family, I must start with my family history. This is a SMS I received on this date from my sister-in-law, whose name is there. Her younger son, Dhruv, had hyperthyroidism. Her whole family has a history of hyperthyroidism. She called me in panic in July of that year, 2011, I think it was. And she said that she has come to some famous hospitals in Bombay. I don't want to name them because this will be on YouTube tomorrow. But she said, everybody said this kid has to be put on steroids. Dhruv at that time was 12 or 13 years old. And she was really distraught because this had happened with the kids of her siblings. And she said, you know, lifetime my child has to spend on steroids. And I said, no, we are going to try some homeopathy. And to cut a long story short, Dhruv was given a course of Argentum Metallicum. And in October, I received this message. But before that, Rochna called me almost every single day. And every single day she told me, my entire family is anti me. My in-laws are anti me. My own husband, that is my elder brother Tarang, he is also upset with me. They are saying, you are crazy, Rajiv is crazy, and you are going to destroy this kid's life. Now tell me, friends, if truly the first S in homeopathy stands for sugar pills, i.e. a placebo, can we have such wonderful results with a young child who is suffering from a very real disease which is completely quantified and analyzed? And jokingly, I tell allopaths sometimes, when they still insist that homeopathy is a placebo, I said, yaar, kam se kam, even if it is a placebo, at least it is a placebo which is tried on a human being and then given to another human being. Aap to aapka jo dawai hai, you try it on rats and rabbits and then say because it works on a rat, it will work on a human being. Isme to koi logic hi nahi. So at least I will rather take a placebo which is tried on a human being than a chemical which is proven on a rodent, because I think I'm a human being, and more like a human being than like a rodent. And the reason I think they don't understand this, and if I have time towards the end, I will show you a video that talks about this, is because there is a very beautiful saying that when the homeopathic remedy talks, as Dr. Saab said, Even the placebo talks, what is the language it talks in? It doesn't talk in English like you and me. It doesn't talk in Hindi or Spanish or Italian or French. It talks in the language of the universe, and the language of the universe is frequency. People who understand frequency can listen to the language of homeopathy, I think. Next, Shahrukh. From family history, we move to family tradition. Now, this is my own example. This is 2016. So I share one family secret with you, but please don't mention outside this room. Our family has a very rich tradition of benign prostatic hyperplasia, enlarged prostate. It is said in the Bajaj family, there are only two types of men, those who have BPH and those who are going to have BPH. Only two types of men are there. So from my grandfather's generation, we have this problem. All of us have this problem. So I used to monitor my PSA, free PSA, as you can see over there, if that is somewhat legible to you, very, very closely, maybe once a year. And it was always around 1.25. And one day in April 2016, I found it is higher. And 10 days later, it had doubled again. And you know, meri to phat gayi. Kya phat gayi, main itne logon ke samne nahi bol sakta hun, par aap samajh sakte hain. I immediately called Dr. Rajan. I was on my way to the hospital because in Pune they wanted me to do, you know what happens with the BPH, right? You have to do the DRE, you have to do the transrectal ultrasound, you have to go into MRI machine, you have to do the alana, phalana, all these things you have to do. So on the way there, I called up Dr. Rajan. Of course, Dr. Rajan doesn't need to even hear my words. He can sense that I am upset. So by the time I was ready to go in the MRI machine, he called me and told me, there is nothing wrong with you. It is something very benign. Before they have finished their investigation, I will treat you. And my final report from the allopaths came a couple of months later from Mumbai, from a specialist in Mumbai. I don't know what it is called. It is some PRADS, IRADS, some analysis is done to grade the BPH. In the 2 months that I got the report from allopathy, already by taking staphysagria 200, my BPH was already over, as you can see over there. The date is sometime, I think, a couple of months later in June or so. It had come down to almost the normal level. Instead of 1.25, it was 1.37. So the second criticism of homeopathy, first is it is sugar pill, second is it is slow. Aray, what is slow? Allopathy ka to report hi nahi aaya mere haath mein. Aur yahan to prostate wapis apne size pe aake baith gaya. So I don't think, in my experience, maybe it's a swallow making one summer, but I don't think in my experience, homeopathy is slow. The third example, the third example is of my most precious family member. His name is Scotch. He's a golden retriever. Scotch and I, like, we are like one, you know. We are what you call heart song, soulmate. So Scotch is very young. He's 13 and a half. He's going to live till he's about 30 or 40 years old because he's in the good care of Dr. Rajan Sankaran. And unfortunately, in September 2018, Scotch is vet in Pune, Dr. Bharat told me, that this hard lump he has got on his elbow is 90% cancerous. Now we all know as laymen, when a doctor says 90% cancerous, means that 10% is only to keep you positive and hopeful. Actually, he means it is 100% cancerous. So I called up, of course, Dr. Rajan, and I said, Dr. Rajan, if this dog dies, I will die with this dog. So please do something. So this third S of homeopathy, steroids. I mean, this kind of malignancy is a problem on which nothing is going to work in allopathy except surgery. And since the dog was 12 years old at that time, surgery was almost out of the question. So there is no antibiotic, there is no steroid, there is no disease-modifying drug that is going to work on him. In 3 months, the tumor shrank. The dog obviously cannot speak. Dr. Rajan, I insisted you have to come to Pune to see my dog, but he never came. So he's not as kind as he always seems, but he prescribed the right medicine from Mumbai itself. And in three months, my dog is fine, and he's absolutely fine, as you can see. He's eating, playing, everything is good. So what have I learned from the experience of Scotch? Friends, I have learned three things. And there are so many more examples I can tell you. One, I have learned that in homeopathy, every disease is addressable. I have never seen a case of any single disease where homoeopaths throw up their hand and say ki ye hamari bas ki baat nahi hai. Every disease is addressable in homeopathy. Second, I have also seen that every patient is not curable. Every disease is addressable, but every patient is not curable. Because conviction and compliance are very important in homeopathy, more than any other pathy, I think. The patient is part of the process. And unless he has and keeps the conviction and complies and enables the homeopath, he cannot be cured, even though his disease is addressable. And the third, I have to also say, I have experienced, every doctor is not a healer. Every homeopath is not a healer. Because as Dr. Rajan always says, the two greatest hallmarks of a homeopath are passion and compassion. Passion for his science and compassion for his patients. Many doctors are good doctors, but they don't always have the passion and the compassion that they need to have. So I'm sure if the doctor has passion and compassion and the patient has conviction and demonstrates compliance, I think every disease is curable within the limits of the vitality of the life force, of course. So if any of you know anyone who is skeptical about homeopathy because it is slow, sugar pill, steroid, etc., Dr. Meghna has got my email. You please give it to them. You tell them to write to me. And you can be sure I will give them a lot of examples to convince them. But you only warn them about one thing, that they must be willing to go by facts, as Dr. Saab said. They must have an open mind and go by facts. Because if they don't, then I will get very annoyed. And let me tell you one thing, I am staphylococcus aureus. If I get annoyed, they will be taking arnica for the rest of their life. So, from family, we will move to business now. Next one, Shahrukh. This is a slide I use often. So if you've heard me speak somewhere before, it is quite possible you've seen this before. I say crime because two of the greatest marketing gurus in the world were Al Rees and Jack Trout. I am fortunate to have been their student. Jack Trout was, in fact, with me for several years, coming from New Jersey to India to teach us, because we were zero in marketing for a long, long time. And Al Rees, in his book, Origin of Brands, in 2004, he gives this damning statistic, which basically says management, that means people like me, my uncles, and you know, so-called business people here, Hitesh Bhai, etc., we are generally wrong 90-95% of the time. I mean, that's the statistic. You know, that's why I always say to people, why are you blaming the government that they have destroyed the economy and that destroys business? The reality, if you read even today's paper, again, I won't take the name of the gentleman because I'm in his city. It is management that destroys businesses, that destroy banks, that destroy the economy. So what is the cause and what is the result should be carefully understood. The cause is not the economy and the result is not bad business. The cause is bad business practices and bad businessmen. And the result is a bad economy. So this is why Dr. Kent used to say, we live in two worlds, the world of cause and the world of result. But sometimes, unfortunately, we don't even know what is cause and what is result. Now, would we send our children to a school which failed 90-95% of the time? Would we go to a restaurant which served terrible food 90% of the time? Would I have come here in an aircraft which doesn't land properly 90% of the time? Of course not. But still, we as managers, and this is a statistic put out by Ernst & Young, we as managers think it is our birthright to fail 90% of the time, and still we will go and give gyan to 500 people when they are willing to listen to you on a Saturday afternoon. This is called management. Now, sometimes people think that, okay, these people are consultants, so they put this information out to create a fear psychosis, so people will go to them and give them some work. So then I share with you the next slide, which is called culprit. This is called culprit because you can find this article in the Harvard Business Review, published by Harvard Business School, which is the mecca of management studies, as you know, in Boston. And incidentally, my whole family has been there except for me. So my father, my brother-in-law, my uncles, everybody has been to Harvard Business School. So I got a real problem with Harvard Business School because I never went to Harvard Business School. In the Harvard Business Review, Harvard Business School puts out the same statistic, which says that basically we fail 90-95% of the time. Minimum 75%, but sometimes even 97% of the time. And I asked you to keep your phones on for one reason. You know why we fail? Because unlike in homeopathy, there are no principles in management. Now you may think I'm joking. I'm not joking. All of you who care to do this, you please switch on your phones along with me, go to Safari, and in Safari, you ask, first law of physics. And you know what will come up? Newton's first law. It states that an object will remain at rest or in uniform motion in a straight line unless acted upon by blah, 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 right? So all of us who have been to school understand this is the first law of physics. Now, follow me. Put in the first law of management. You know what it says? The first law of management. Newton's first law of motion states that an object will remain blah, blah, blah. Think of your organizational change program for a moment as the object in Newton's first law. Means, sorry for my language, ghanta, there is no law in management at all. If you do the same thing afterwards, if you put in the second law of thermodynamics, you will get the second law of thermodynamics about the entropy in the system and blah, blah, blah. And if you ask for the second law of management, it will tell you to go to the second law of thermodynamics. There is nothing called principle or law or aphorism in management. That is why management fails 90% of the time. That is why I did not go to management school. I went to homoeopathy school. And still, if there are some last few skeptics left in the audience, there's a very famous professor called Professor Clayton Christensen. He died recently of cancer, I think, just last month, I think. Professor Clayton Christensen was a tenured professor at Harvard Business School. He is most famous for his work on a subject called disruption. And it is said that all the tech gurus of Silicon Valley grew up kind of absorbing his knowledge or his theories and implementing them. So he's an iconic figure in Silicon Valley. So Dr. Clayton Christensen propounded a theory called disruption. And he was a tenured professor of Harvard Business School. And he spent a lot of time towards the end of his career trying to understand, as you will see in a short video I will just show you, why is it that companies which do so well, till a certain point, they fail? And you will be amazed by what he says at the end. I am saying it because his accent may not be clear to everyone. He says, they fail because of the principles of management we teach them at Harvard Business School. This is the tenured professor of Harvard Business School. This is not fake news. This is not from social media cell of any political party. This is straight from Harvard Business School. Please watch for 30 seconds. Sharuk.
Why is success so difficult to sustain? If you look across the sweep of business history, most companies, which at one point were widely regarded as unassailably successful, a decade or two later, you find them in the middle of the pack and often at the bottom of the heap. And I reached the strangest conclusion after having studied this for a number of years, which is that it's actually the principles of good management that we teach at the Harvard Business School that sow the seeds of every company's ultimate failure.
It is the principles of good management we teach at Harvard Business School that sow the seeds of every company's ultimate failure. That is why we are failing, because we are studying at Harvard Business School. So, friends, after this, I want to share with you, I mean, I have very little knowledge of homoeopathy, to be honest, but I have learned a few good things which have helped me in my work. Of that, I want to share with you today, in the next few minutes, what I consider 7 principles, what I have understood. So I am not here at all to convince anybody about homoeopathy. It is beyond my ability. But I want to ask you to try to relate to these principles. If you think the principles make sense, then we have to agree that homoeopathy makes sense. So let's start with the first one. Next. The first principle is the principle called individualization. So I think we all know that perhaps this is the founding principle of homoeopathy. When I grew up in the village of Akurdi in Pune, everything we wanted, from our school bag to our umbrella to our talcum powder to our shoes to our books, there's a shop outside our house called Chetan Medical and General Stores. So you went to a general store, you bought everything. Today you go to a different store for each of these things. All our life we were looked after by a wonderful GP called Dr. Mohile. Today nobody goes to a GP. For every organ of the body, there is one specialist who is never available, he's so busy. So, in short, the world moves from generalization to specialization. That is why I think any general comment such as this community is good, this community is not good, I think it is not correct. Because as he has said, generalization is the true enemy of man. Do not generalize anything. So opposite of generalization, to be specialized or to be individualized, as I understand, is one of the fundamental principles of homeopathy. And what this means, as Dr. Saab was saying earlier, is the homeopath believes we all have a constitution. It is our structure or our framework or our algorithm or whatever it is, our constitution. And what makes us who we are as individuals, because we all believe we are individuals, is what is it that is strange or rare or peculiar or queer or uncommon in our constitution, which is most unlike other people in how we act or react. This is my understanding as a layman about this principle of individualization of homeopathy. Now, how this has helped me in my work? As much as there is a constitution for a human being, in business we say every company has a business model. People like it very much when I tell this joke, so I will say it once more, although it has been said too many times. You know what was the problem of business model of Kingfisher Airlines? No business and too many models. This is the problem of Kingfisher Airlines. So we say, just as people have a constitutional problem, businesses have a business model problem. What is the solution? We have to find what is individualized in our business model. Like the homeopath tries to find what is individualized or distinct in the constitution of an individual. In marketing language, we call it USP, unique selling proposition, or a point of difference, differentiation. How did Bajaj Auto try to differentiate itself? If we wanted to be the largest motorcycle maker in the world, it is not possible because Honda was already there. If we wanted to be makers of the biggest motorcycle, not possible. Triumph was always there. Makers of the cheapest motorcycle, of course, we would never do that. But if that were possible, the Chinese are already there. So it is no point being like somebody else. There has to be something different about you. So we set ourselves a goal 15 years back of being the most versatile motorcycle manufacturer. What does that mean? In simple words, it means today Bajaj, as I told you earlier, is able to sell a motorcycle for as little as $400 to Africa and still make money on it. And yet we are the same company whose racing motorcycles under the brand KTM, of which one very famous customer is here, Dr. Massimo. These are race spec motorcycles. They are also made by Bajaj and sold in Europe for 6,000, 8,000, 10,000 euro, and we make money on that also. So to have the versatility in the same company to address the entire spectrum of motorcycle markets and customers from $400 to maybe 10,000 euros, this unique capability nobody had. This unique capability we developed, and the spark to develop that came from homeopathy, and that is the reason we are the world's favorite Indian today. So I always give credit to homeopathy for giving us this strategy to be the world's favorite Indian. Next one, sir. The second principle, very deep principle of homeopathy, as I understand, is that of holism. Managers are the biggest reductionists in the world, because whatever problem we see, we just see what we see immediately on the surface, one dimension, and we want to solve the problem, and we wonder why this problem keeps coming back again and again, because we have not gone to the root cause of the problem. We have not gone to the root cause because we are like the blind man on the elephant. Everybody thinks the elephant is a fan or a rope or a pillar because he doesn't see the full picture. We all know very well, I mean, managers are not without common sense. We understand that when we win a race, we don't say my legs won the race, we say I won the race. When we have gangrene, we don't say my leg has gangrene, we say I have gangrene. But who is this I, which is more than just the leg, or in the words of our great founder Dr. Hahnemann, a symptom is no more a disease than a leg, a whole human being. To understand this principle and what it means in terms of taking a 360 degree view of the problem one is dealing with, whether for me it's a marketing problem or for you it is a medical problem, I think most of the time, at least in management, we are not doing like this. And one of the tools or techniques that helped us here were, again, comes from Dr. Kent, who propounded the simple concept of the three-legged stool, and said that you need at least three legs for a stool to be stable. So when I look at a patient, as we saw in the wonderful, short but wonderful case study, you look at the mental symptoms, you look at the general symptoms, and you look, of course, at the chief complaint or the specific symptoms. So in the same way, a very simple translation of that, which may seem very simplistic to you, but let me tell you, it's very, very powerful when applied in actual business practice, is of creating a three-legged stool every time we are making a product. When we get people from R&D, engineering, production, purchase, marketing, sales, distribution, finance together, we look at a three-legged stool for a product, even if it is a bottle of water. And what is the three-legged stool? One is the price, because no customer will buy what he cannot afford. The second is the performance. In our case, what is the mileage, what is the power, what is the comfort, what is the safety, etc., etc. Here it may be about taste or texture or flavor or something like that. And third is what we call design or styling, the form, the features. Here it is also about the look of a bottle. You'll be surprised how many times, if you're used to buying a particular shaving foam and the bottle changes or the color changes, even if the name is the same, you will pause for 5 seconds because you're not sure whether you're buying the same stuff. So it doesn't matter whether it's water, whether it's toothpaste, whether it's motorcycles, whether it's a watch. Price, performance, and design is a very, very enduring three-legged stool for creating a very powerful product strategy. Where did it come from? It came from Dr. Kent. Next. A third principle of homeopathy, as I understand, is the principle of vitality. And as you can understand, those of you who are homeopaths will understand, this is particularly important to me. Because to me, the biggest problem in life is suppression. Suppression creates staphysagria, right? So vitality is so important because it's an inside-out process, an inside-out process of health, an inside-out process of realization, an inside-out process of improvement. Simply put, we would say to anyone that if you have a mishap, if you have an accident and you break your leg, don't immediately use a crutch. First, do your physio and try to get back to normal. If at the end of it you are not able to and you still need a walking stick, it's okay. But the sequence should be in that way. I think it's the same thing whenever I talk to people about homeopathy, that we are, nobody here, as the good doctor said before me, is against anypathy, including allopathy. The question is, what should be the first port of call? What is in your best interest at the very beginning? And I think anything that doesn't just palliate and certainly doesn't suppress, but anything that vitalizes you from inside should be the first port of call. This is this principle of vitality as I understand it. And by vitalization, obviously we don't just mean a physical or a material vitalization of the body or the tissues or the bones or the joints. We are talking also vitalization in a dynamic sense of the vital force, the life force, of the energy, of the chi, of the prana. And let me give you a simple example. This is about 30 years old. We have all heard of the Vicks VapoRub, and we have all used Vicks at some point of time. So about 30 years ago, I remember reading a case study where the company that makes Vicks VapoRub conducted an experiment. There were 100 kids who had a flu, like some people have right now. Yeah, that's right. And 50 of them got Vicks VapoRub applied by someone, maybe the nurse or whoever it was. And in case of 50 kids, their mother applied Vicks VapoRub. Those 50 kids healed much faster. What does it mean? Is it only Vicks VapoRub? There is an energy, there is a frequency in what the mother is doing, which has healed the child much, much faster. Now, how this is to be captured and understood as vitality, I think is very important in our organization. An example of how we have applied this, 15 years ago, our R&D was a big zero. People in the company used to laugh. Bajaj R&D means repeat and duplicate. That is the meaning of R&D. We started with a team of only 4 people, but we said we are going to build the best R&D, motorcycle R&D in the world. A young engineer who was just 2 years younger than me and had joined the company 1 year before me because I studied a master's and came, he went directly from college. His name is Abraham Joseph, we call him Joe. Joe was there at 23. He was given this task. In fact, Joe and team are the ones who created the motorcycle Pulsar, and they had never created anything before that. Can you imagine the kind of bets companies have to place when they are desperate? You have to go down to a 24-year, 25-year-old kids And the future of the company is not in the hands of people like us who come and present and all. That is only to show you. It's actually in the hands of the kids who are creating the R&D of the future. And that is what Joe and his team did. From four people, Joe has built this R&D into a team of 1,250 people today. And every KTM and every electric Chetak that you may have read about and every three-wheeler and every Cute and every Pulsar Avenger is created by them. And why I tell you about Joe, because in year 2000, for those of you who know what it means, Joe was diagnosed with macular dystrophy. And he was told that within a matter of years, and his family is in Kerala, he was alone. I went with him to Dr. Rajiv Raut, who's the ophthalmologist in Pune, very well known. And all the tests were done, macular dystrophy was confirmed. And obviously, I mean, a person who loses or heavily compromises eyesight cannot be an R&D person at all, because his work is in millimeters and microns. With homeopathy, Joe's eyes never deteriorated. It remained the same for the last 20 years. So that's the example of vitality in building R&D. Next, yeah, like cures like. A very, very fundamental principle of homeopathy. You know, if while coming here, if something, you know very well, if something untoward happened with you, maybe you lost your wallet, maybe somebody grazed your car, you know, all kinds of things happen in the city of Mumbai. So if for any reason you were bugged, and I were to ask you, why are you bugged? And you said, oh, this is what happened. And if I made fun of you saying, hey, tumhare Mumbai mein toh aise hi chalta hai, trying to lighten you up, but you would actually get more irritated because you are unhappy and I'm trying to make fun of that or make light of it. But if I showed you this picture out of Africa where this vulture is waiting for this child to die of starvation, and if you dwelt on it for even 10 seconds, for sure you will not remember what happened to you on the way here. Because the grief in this picture is so overwhelming that it will completely squash and remove your own grief from your mind. To me, as a layman, this is the meaning of like cures like. And in fact, I say to allopaths often in Pune, in fact, just last night, why do you say that there is no science in homeopathy? Aapka vaccination bhi toh wohi hai. You also claim like cures like. Wohi virus dalta hoon, wohi virus ko theek karne ke liye. But there is a fundamental difference. In fact, there are three fundamental differences, like we discussed. First of all, your vaccine is not individualized. You treat everybody the same, generalized. Secondly, there is nothing holistic about you. You will look at the virus and you will pump whatever you want in our body. And thirdly, there is nothing dynamic. There is nothing diluted, super diluted. You will take the material and put it in, and 74% of those kids will become autistic tomorrow and you will not be able to trace it back to you. That is your good luck. So what is to be understood as like cures like? I think we have to scratch beneath the surface to understand this. How did this help us, for example? As I told you more than once, we were a company that had no exports. Today, almost half of what we make is exported. So we said to ourselves, let us also take an individualized, holistic, dynamic view of the situation. Dynamic means you take the feedback, you make the improvement, you take the feedback, you make the improvement. We first started, therefore, with the lowest potency, exporting to Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, because they were markets like India. We said, if we succeed here, we will succeed there also. In phase two, we went to Africa, where we are now one out of three motorcycles. That was a bigger challenge, so we kept it for later. Because Africa is far away. If the motorcycle has a problem, we won't be able to service the customer in time. We will lose our name and we will lose our market forever. So that we took in the next stage. And learning from that, we went to LATAM, we went to ASEAN, and finally to the US, European, Japanese markets. So in this way, taking a like cures like approach, that if as a company we cannot export, and I don't want to take too many names, but other Indian automakers, and you know who the names are, their exports are 2%, 4%, 8%. You can Google all this afterwards at the end of the day. Why is it only almost 50% in the case of Bajaj? And I think the single biggest reason for that is this, because unlike them, we didn't say they're not able to export. So let us sell more in the domestic market. Let us reduce the price. Let us create some other product segment. We said, no, like cures like. If we are not capable of export, we must export. but not with such a high potency immediately that it will aggravate us. Let us go step by step, Sri Lanka, Africa, Colombia, America, in this way. So I would say at a very, very fundamental level, our export strategy also, and if you know people who are part of my company, you will know, this is exactly what we discussed. And we used to talk in homeopathic terms, we used to give these examples, and we used to craft our export strategy on this basis. So I would say, in the context of like cures like, our export strategy owes itself to this kind of thinking. The next one is of the single remedy. A good homeopath, as we know, will only give you one remedy at one time. Now, believe it or not, this is me doing a headstand in Rishikesh. But you can see in the headstand, I'm also doing forward bending, I'm doing forward split, I'm doing a side split, I'm doing a Padmasana, I'm doing twisting, etc. In other words, in one asana, Guruji V.K.S. Iyengar taught me to do so many different asanas. Isn't that the same how it is in homeopathy? Why did I do this? Because I was actually hurt. My neck was hurt, my cervical disc was out, and I was told the last thing you will do is a headstand. And Guruji was not a homeopath, but he told me the first thing you will do a headstand. Because he didn't use these words, but the meaning of his words were like will cure like. You will stand on your head, and the secondary reaction which will come after the primary action will heal you. And after several years, I did my MRI again, and my disc had gone back inside. That means in one asana, I could perform all the asanas required to heal myself. I didn't have to do 20 asanas. In the same way, there is a saying in homeopathy, as I understand, all the local symptoms should be in the global picture, and in the global picture should be all the local. So the global should be in all the local should be in global. And sometimes in our company, when my father, our chairman, even my uncles who are here present today, often said, why are you not making a scooter? Bajaj is scooter and scooter is Bajaj. Why are you only making a motorcycle? And my answer to them was, which they never understood, only one remedy at a time. We will start first with one remedy. And we will become world class in one remedy. From being the last motorcycle maker in the world 18 years ago, we are today the number three motorcycle maker in the world. We are still not number one. And number one is not important. The question is, you must be excellent. You must be world class. That is what is important. Because number one means number one in what? In volume, in profits, in market cap. There can be so many discussions about what is the meaning of number one. But we must be excellent. So we said at one time, we will do one thing. But in that one thing will be everything. All our R&D skills, all our engineering skills, all our production skills, all our marketing skills, and all the money that we need to make so that we can have a 100 crore CSR budget every year so that we can support homeopathy will all come from the motorcycle. So everything can be achieved from one thing as long as we have taken a holistic view of that one thing. Next shot. This is a very beautiful and I think very underestimated concept by the lay people, not by the homeopaths. The concept of the smallest dose. My favorite author was always Hans Christian Andersen. I even went to Copenhagen to his museum and saw everything, etc. And my favorite story of Hans Christian Andersen was the story of the emperor's new clothes. Where, as you know very well, jab sab log vaa vaa karte hain, aajkal bhi wahi chal raha hai. It takes a child sometimes to stand up and say, par emperor to nanga hai. You know, that means if the thing is true or if the thing is right in homeopathic terms, if the similimum is good, then the smallest dose is enough. You don't have to worry too much about pushing it through. We say to ourselves in our company, if we have a resistance down the line, management wants to do something. If we sense a resistance, don't blame the people and don't blame the execution. You have to ask yourself, if my dealers are not happy, there is something wrong with this dose. The similimum is not right. The idea is not right. Because if the idea is right, the smallest dose will go through. Otherwise, we spend our whole lifetime in the belief that our idea is correct, the execution has to improve. And we lose years and years and years in the process. And homeopathy teaches us those three beautiful words, the promise of the rapid, gentle, and permanent cure. And I saw this, as I told you just briefly before, in my own company so many times, but the first time with the Pulsar, where four little boys, if I may call them that because they were in their 20s, could create a motorcycle that turned the destiny of such a big company We're all great Rati Maharatis like us. We could not do anything. But these four kids could change it. Because their idea of making a Pulsar which was unlike any other motorcycle, it was uncommon, it was differentiated, it was individualized. Because their idea was good, the smallest dose was enough to make the company healthy again. This is very, very important, I think. And the next and last one, I think, is the concept of the potentized repetition. So what you see on the top left is the first Pulsar we ever made, and as you go across the top row, this is how it improved, and then you go along the bottom row, this is how it improved, and in homeopathy you call it posology. And I think even homeopaths underestimate posology. They think ek bar remedy correct hai to phir posology chalega. Potency, size of the dose, frequency, not so important. At least this has been my experience with a lot of homeopaths. But I feel, no, this is very, very important. And I tell my people all the time, as much as the follow-up, as much as the eye on the potency, the eye on the frequency, the eye on the size of the dose is important for a homeopath to keep, we as managers have to be very, very aware that once we are given a dose, those golden words, wait and watch, is so important. It is so important, friends, because in management, we don't have any humility to observe. Because we are so egoistic, we only want to think. Because thinking is a great process. It is a very creative process. We all want to be creative. We want to think. We want to think, and most of the time it comes out of the wrong place. That is from our ego or from our pride or something like that. And most of the time it is theoretical. On the other hand, what managers need to do when they go to a market where there is competition is to observe before they think. Ki idhar kya ho raha hai, kyun ho raha hai, kaisa ho raha hai. They need to be humble. They need to be centered, not creative. They need to be practical, not theoretical. And this I learned when I saw homeopaths taking follow-up of case after case, that how closely they monitor the posology, how they adjust the dose. Sometimes they adjust upward, sometimes they adjust downward, sometimes they give a placebo, sometimes they will change something. How they keep fine-tuning it in such a finely artistic fashion. That is the beauty of homeopathy to a layman like me. Otherwise, mechanically, you know what they say, to a man with a hammer, everything is a nail. Go and keep banging at everything and some problem will be solved. That is why we are successful 5% of the time and failing 95% of the time. So this was another, I would say, the seventh great learning to me from homeopathy. Now I come to the last slide. Thank you, Shahrukh. I'm sorry, I've overrun my time already. Friends, I've tried to share with you very, very quickly what I have, a few of the things I have learned from homeopathy. But I like to leave you also, you know, there are some intelligent people in the management world also. One of them is this guy called Vaclav Schmil. He is considered to be a polymath, which basically means a very wise person. It is said that Bill Gates reads everything that he writes. And these are the five things that Vaclav Schmil tells managers. And I think it is important to share this with homeopaths and with those who are, lovers of homeopathy. First is read widely and with maximum curiosity. I think because I read widely about homeopathy since 2002, I am a better person for it. So I urge you also as homeopaths or those related to homeopathic fraternity, please read widely and with great curiosity all the time. I see this with, if I may say so, with Dr. Rajan all the time. All the time he's reading, all the time he's writing a book, all the time he's having a seminar, all the time he's teaching. How much energy is going into, just keeping yourself abreast? Second, as simple as it sounds, put reality first and theory last. So many cases are lost by putting theory first. Very, very important to put reality first. Leave money and status out of it. I tell you, one time in May 2017, I was somewhat unhappy about something, and Dr. Rajan sent me one quote, and it said, "The true reward for a man's toil is not what he gets for it, but what he becomes because of it." And I said to myself, that's right. It's nothing to do with money and status. It is what you feel is your realization through your work. That is the biggest satisfaction. For me to see a motorcycle in different parts of the world serving a different purpose for different customers, that is really a great source of satisfaction. When my people come back and say, there was a big queue in the immigration in Mexico, and when I put my passport, they all applauded me and say, you are Bajaj. My goodness. I mean, that is a wonderful feeling that the name of our country is known across the world. So in the same way, it is nothing to do with money and status. So as homeopaths, don't ever bother about talks about money and status and all these things. This is not important. Manage your identity. As I said in the beginning, as I took the liberty of saying, please don't build a bridge to becoming dentists and allopaths and all these kind of things. You are homeopaths. You are great people. Please stay homeopaths. And lastly, have skin in the game, which to me means that don't just look after patients well, but give something back to homeopathy. Start a little institute, write a book, have a seminar, call me to speak, I will come, no problem. So on and so forth. So friends, I just want to finish by saying that, you know, I'm a very grateful beneficiary of homeopathy, as you can probably tell by now. I support it in whatever way I can. I'm very fond and very proud of what we have done at Prana in Pune. Some of my colleagues are here from there. And we are very lucky that at Prana we have yoga and homeopathy. So Guruji Iyengar guided us till he was there till 2014 on yoga. And Dr. Rajan continues to guide us along with his team on homeopathy. So that is something very, very close to my heart. And then, of course, whether it's at Apti in Lonavala or elsewhere. I mean, I can just say in one sentence, don't misunderstand me. I'm not trying to show off. Homeopathy will never in India lack funds as long as you people are doing the kind of work you're doing, because people like us are with you. So don't ever worry on that account. You know? And it's not just people like us. You'll be surprised. If we have 3-4 minutes, Dr. Rajan, can I show? There's a 4-minute video of a very well-known person from medical field in one of the best-known universities in the US. And this is what he has to say in the context of homeopathy. So it's not exactly about homeopathy, but still, I think it's relevant, you will enjoy it. Let's see.
I want to turn to the kind of science we're doing here at Penn State. The two things we're following are, one, in the area of water. I'm a material scientist, I know a heck of a lot about structure of matter. And so we've been looking at water, and in that study we have totally disproved the attack that scientists make on homeopathy, for instance. They say, aha, well, you see, if you dilute, if there's no solute molecules in the water, as you do in homeopathy, they put something in, then they dilute it, and they dilute it again, and they say, well, there's no molecules left, so ha-ha, that can't be scientific. Wrong, wrong, wrong. In material science, it is structure that counts, not chemistry. The unfortunate part about Western scientific medicine, so-called, is that it is dedicated to biochemistry, as though we are only body bags. But we are not. We are electromagnetic entities. We are very finely tuned computers and radios and all those combined. We are electromagnetic entities and acoustic entities, so that we can be influenced by acoustic signals, by magnetic fields, by electrical fields. And the poor old scientific medicine forgot all the physics, because they were all chemists like me. I'm a chemist. See, we forgot all about the physics. The future of high-tech medicine, I don't call it scientific, high-tech medicine, is going to be on devices employing the laws of physics, not chemistry. Chemistry is over. Biochemistry, it's obviously finished. It costs $1 billion to make a new pill, and most of them don't work. That's great, right? So we're not going to do much more of that. It's over. The physics side is good. So we're seeing at Penn State, we're looking at all these devices. Magnetic field devices for your knees, for your things, for sleep, for pain. You can stop pain by just exposing yourself to a bunch of radiation. So why am I doing all that other stuff, which is much more hurtful? So we're looking at that, and we're looking, what we do is simply do the science. We don't try to tell you whether it works for pain, works for this, or works for your acne. We're not into that. We're not clinicians. But we do say, what is it? What are the facts about this device? What are the fields? What are the frequencies? So we are calibrating that. The other area where we are working, and we have become a service of a high-tech university to the whole field of whole person healing. We cannot prove that any of their stuff works for any healing, but we can sure tell him what it does, what's going on. So we find in that, that in water, is the other area. We said, well, we don't know a lot about that stuff. Let's see what it does. And we found the most extraordinary stuff. Some of these people have these silver colloids, company in Utah, and the silver colloid kills bugs, even though there's only one atom of silver metal in a million atoms of water. So it's purer than your drinking water. And yet that's a very good antibiotic. So we say, aha, how is this working? Maybe it is structure instead of the chemistry. Obviously, there's not much chemistry there. You've got only one. In fact, they dilute it to 1 in 100 million. It still works, like homeopathy. Now you see the similarities. So we've been looking in great detail at the structure of water. And we'll be reporting a series of papers as a contribution on the structure of water. Obviously, most of us are made up of water, our cells are water, so any contribution we make, maybe we can help the case. Like in science, we'll put a couple more bricks in place, but those bricks are kind of shaking up the anti-homeopathy crowd, because now they've got no place to hide, they were just plain and simple wrong. So that's the areas we at Penn State have become a resource to the whole person healing community by bringing physics and chemistry to serve that area. They haven't had access to that. Now we go to the last one. Spiritual healing.
So friends, this is a very senior person, as you can see, at Penn State in the US, telling us very briefly about the structure of things and how that is relevant to homeopathy and how that helps us understand better the action and efficacy of homeopathy. So to end, I tell you my perception. My perception is that, you know, I've seen over the last 17 years of my being interested in homeopathy that there are so many challenges. At the one end of the spectrum, ignorant politicians are a challenge. Big pharma will always be a challenge. Even the perception of the common man is a challenge. Even the other day, last week, somebody said to me, "Arey kya ye homeopathy? Koi standard nahi hai, koi regulations nahi hai, koi regulator nahi hai." So I told him, "Yeah, I know there is a madness out there, but there is one method also in that madness." And what I told him, that quote I want to leave with you. I started with a quote, I want to finish with it. And that quote goes like this: "Manzil milegi." Because there is a madness, no? So all homeopaths and homeopathic fellows like me, we are all lost somewhere outside. Manzil milegi, bhatak kar hi sahi. Gumrah to wo hai jo ghar se nikle hi nahi. So at least one person should whistle, I think. Somebody whistle. Come. So, you have given me 45 minutes to homeo quack like me on a weekend. Thank you very, very much.